Hi and welcome. Here is one of my favorite sound cards. It has an ESS AudioDrive chip, which sounds great. It has an IDE connector for your CD-ROM, a wavetable header, and even jumpers to select if the output should be amplified. Let's try it out. It gets initialized just fine with Unisound. Let's try some games. Its FM synthesizer sounds pretty good, even though it's not a genuine OPL3. But some later DOS games, like Warcraft II, don't sound too great using OPL3 sound. They are really designed for general MIDI. Yeah, it's okay, but it sounds a lot better like this. So how can we get general MIDI with this sound card? The obvious answer, of course, is with a wavetable module. There are quite a few modern wavetable modules out there to choose from, so we're going to do the right thing and build yet another one. But first, let's try to understand what the wavetable header is and how we can use it. The pinout of the wavetable header looks like this. It has 3 5-volt pins, several ground pins, and one MIDI TTL pin. It also has 2 input pins, the left and right channel audio. But how does this relate to the game port at the back? Isn't this where external MIDI modules are usually connected to? Let's find out. The only pin we're interested in is the MIDI TTL pin, so let's use the multimeter in continuity mode to figure out what it is connected to. There is continuity to this 2.2K resistor. Now let's find out which game port pin is connected to this resistor. And yeah, it is pin 12, so the wavetable MIDI pin is the same as the game/MIDI port pin 12. We don't need to trace the left and right audio pins, because external MIDI modules return the audio externally through the line in. Okay, so the wavetable is similar to the game/MIDI port, but better, as we can return the audio through the wavetable header itself. So here is the plan. We can use our Raspberry Pi and connect it to the wavetable's MIDI pin, have it synthesize general MIDI, and feed the audio back into the wavetable's audio pins. Since the Raspberry Pi works with 3-volt GPIOs, we need a simple voltage divider to reduce the MIDI TTL signal down to 3 volts. Of course, the Raspberry Pi will be running MT32Pi. If you're not aware of the MT32Pi project, please check it out. It is an awesome project for the Raspberry Pi that runs MUNT and Fluid Synth on bare metal, so you can emulate all sorts of cool MIDI synthesizers, including MT32, Sound Canvas, and of course General MIDI, and you can even add your own sound fonts. Okay, so here are the boards that we're going to use for this project. There is space for a Raspberry Pi 02W at the back, and on the front we can add an OLED display and a high fidelity DAC module. Here are the parts we need. The parts on the right are required, while the parts on the left are optional. We need, of course, the PCB and a double row female header to plug it into the wavetable header of the sound card. A Raspberry Pi 02W, older versions won't work because they are not fast enough, and a male header to attach it to the board. A microSD card. MT32Pi requires just a few megabytes, so any size should do. A 10K and a 22K resistor for the GPIO voltage divider that we mentioned earlier. And finally, 2 10 microfarad ceramic capacitors. Now for the optional parts. A PCM5102A HiFi DAC module of this specific form factor and a single row header to attach it to the board, a 2x3 double row header for the audio select jumpers and the two jumpers, and a 0.91 inch OLED SSD 1306 I2C display. Okay, let's do some soldering. The audio select header allows you to select the source of the audio, whether it's going to be the Pi's PWM audio or the DAC. You can simply bridge them with some short wires, but I will install them anyway. For now we will be using the PWM audio, so that will be position 1-2 for both jumpers. We could solder the header to the board and then the Raspberry Pi onto the header, but there would be a sizable gap between the Pi and the board. The issue is that there may not be enough clearance for the wavetable header in sound cards with lots of components. So instead, I will skip the spacer and solder the Pi such that it touches the board. I will use some Kapton tape to avoid any short circuits. Now that one end of the header is soldered to the Pi, let's try to remove the plastic spacer from the other end. Well, it's harder than I thought. The only way that seems to work is to cut the header into smaller parts and remove them one by one. Be careful when cutting the pins. These things are flying across the room. Okay, the simplest version of the Wavetable Pi is now ready. We need to make sure that we plug it in correctly. The right hand side of the board should be on pin 1 of the wavetable header. And now the smoke test. Well, the Pi's LED is lighting up, that's good. Since we are setting this up as a general MIDI device, we need to make a couple of changes to the mt32pi.cfg configuration file. Okay, let's play some MIDI audio. Total silence. What is going on? Why are we not getting any sound? Well, the LED is showing some activity, so it must be doing something. After some investigation, I figured out that the audio selection jumper table was wrong, so we just need to move the jumpers to the other pins. Cool, it works, but the audio quality is quite poor, there's a lot of noise. This is because it's coming from the GPIOs of the Raspberry Pi. This can be fixed with the addition of the high fidelity DAC. Okay, it's now ready, but we first need to change some options in the configuration file of the mt32pi. Oh, and we need to change the audio select jumpers again. Yeah, this is so much better. I'm not getting any audio from the wavetable module in this game. The game seems to mute the wavetable input when it starts. I believe this is so, because if I reset the computer while the game runs, I can hear some hanging MIDI audio coming from the Pi when the card initializes. If anyone knows how to fix this, please let me know. Okay, time to add the final part, the OLED display. Please make sure there is enough clearance between the display module and the header pins. For the display to work, we once again need to update the configuration file. Nice, it works perfectly. Okay, that's all for now. As always, the sources and the Gerber files for this project are available on GitHub. The link is in the description below. Thanks for watching and goodbye!